The premise of the game, I said, was, I didn't tell you much, I just said that you are two, like, electronic music festival archetypes. So do you want to kind of introduce your characters while I bring my stool back up?
Yes, this is going to be a repeating bit. It's not actually a bit. For some reason, these bar stools on our bar, one of the hydraulic mechanisms is just kind of messed up.
I feel like you guys are the only ones falling.
No, it's just me. Both of yours are fine. Like, I think that it drops to the same height. I feel like you could see it on the camera in real time.
Anyway, as the host of this show, I will introduce your character first.
Oh.
Which you will do with your mouth and your words.
Oh, I was going to tell you to get your pit vipers so you could both, in character, wear the pit vipers.
Oh, that's true. My character would not wear the pit vipers.
Oh, okay.
But from neither the looks of the very large name that Tanner wrote that I was pretty close to guessing,
yeah,
his character would.
I'm calling a judge. She's reading my character sheet. It's supposed to be a fucking secret.
It's not a secret. We're about to spill off, man.
Okay, you go ahead.
We're going into details here.
Well, I would say, tell us what your name is, what you look like, and your general background. You don't have to, like, get into your stats and your inventory and stuff. That can kind of come out.
Okay, should I do it in the voice, too? Probably, because
that's creative.
That'll probably make it better. Okay, so, my name is Courtney. It's the name that was given to me by my single mother, and I want to honor that because that's what she gave me when I was born. But I'm actually known as Starseed Child of the Indigo Night, or at Starseed on Instagram and TikTok.
Wait, she got at Starseed? Like, that's actually pretty impressive, like, on the ball.
I know.
Like, right? As soon as a new platform opens, you're like, I'm getting Starseed on everything.
Kelly, hold on.
What?
This, she's not real.
But I'm just enamored by the character. Like, I assume that Instagram and TikTok are as real in this universe.
Absolutely.
Okay.
She's got awful matted blonde dreads with grass, dirt, and flowers stuck in them. A very nice long yellow a purple flowery sundress because she's an indigo child.
Wait, is the word patchouli on your character sheet?
It's actually not, but I do have sage, though. She's got super dirty bare feet with band-aids because she stepped on a rusty nail at one of the stages. She doesn't shave anything. Anything at all.
No judgment.
For background, she's feminist as fuck. Burn the patriarchy.
What, you wrote all of the rest of that stuff not in the background panel?
No, this is what she looks like.
Oh, okay. I see.
Yeah.
She looks like a feminist. Like, she has no background.
That's
cool. That's that's Courtney.
Well, I didn't write about my character's Instagram.
Starseed. Her friends call her Starseed.
All right, my character's name is Brad. He wears a black baseball hat, a black tee, and blue jeans.
How did I know you're
slender and stoic? He's adopted, has a very bland personality, and techno is the only interest or hobby he's ever had, and he's depressed.
I will give him credit for this. It's not psytrance.
It's close enough. It's in the same ballpark.
I mean, I believe you. They all sound the same.
Brad would kill me if I said that. But
like, all the genres do sound the same, but somehow psytrance is worse. That's all I know.
That's awesome because we just came from Inshallah, which is a very,
like, very psytrance.
Oh, I noticed festival.
Large representation of psytrance.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. So yeah, that's Brad.
All right.
He plays techno.
Oh, is he DJ?
Yeah. So I actually was like trying to think of the name, right?
And
I
totally know you were gonna go for like the DJ playing route.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, I was like,
his name is Chad, isn't it?
I feel like the low hanging fruit was like the Wook.
I know, and I took that fruit, but I did it well.
Yeah. See, I went a layer above that, Callie.
I don't know if it's above or below, really.
Okay, so. You two are at a unnamed music festival in southern BC.
Which one?
It's kind of near like a little sleepy mountain town, and it's on like a big farm.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, you two are in the same
Woodstock.
Yeah. Yeah, you're a Woodstock. You two are in a camp together. Do you know each other?
Ooh, interesting
question. I would almost say no. I feel like our characters are pretty opposite.
Yeah. I feel like it's more fun if you don't know each other. Yeah.
You probably don't hang out in the same crowd.
Yeah.
Well, you're in the same camp. You're about to take a drug together. And
oh, here we go.
Yeah. So I don't know, like maybe tell me like what the connection is. Like you have a mutual here or
let's
sister's friend or something?
Like, yeah. Some sort of family member or a friend camp. Of a friend sort of deal brought us into the same camp.
Okay. Well, that person is there. And so is a guy named Bearcat. He's like a pudgy guy with a big beard. He does like a whole thing where he'll walk around with like a sign that says like free hugs, like hugs for, we'll trade hugs for hugs. That's what he does. Mm, right.
That's even worse.
Yeah.
Trying to be clever.
He's got like extremely nasty dreads.
I probably know him.
Yeah. And he's excited. He's got this like foil thing and he's like, all right guys, we're going to try this new awesome thing. Acid out the door. This is a sweet new chemical called LSZ. Oh,
why would you bring that up?
Oh no, this is...
And everyone has taken a gummy in their hand, and everyone is really excited. So, yeah, so you guys are about to take this. Is there anything you want to do before you, like, pop it in your mouth?
God, I feel like I want to know the context as to how we all got convinced to do it.
Bearcat's very convincing. Sure. He's really stoked. He's like, I've been researching all these RCs. Yeah. And like, yeah, so this one, it's basically like the same, but it's like, it lasts a little longer and it's kind of like a little stronger. And you just get like, yeah, it's just, you get more of a vibe, if that makes sense. Yeah. Like, oh, it vibes
so
you harder.
Into vibes, bro. Yeah.
I'll just draw on my personal experience of being convinced to do that thing. So, yeah.
But yeah, you neither of you has ever heard of this substance. And yeah.
I'm gonna take the this is too close. I'm gonna take the gummy in my hand, and like this, as the sun is setting, I'm just gonna sit there with it, and I'm just gonna put so much energy and just loving intention into this trip because I want it to be super magical, and like I want to just like learn a lot of things from it.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah, I probably can envision Brad standing there and just internally like mocking the shit out of you as you spend a lot of effort proclaiming all of that to the rest of us.
I'm like half proclaiming, but I'm also just kind of sitting there with my eyes closed, just like kind of like mumbling some like weird like speaking in tongue shit, like
yeah putting on a show, right? Yeah. Whereas like I probably just like the halfway through Bearcat trying to convince me to do it, I'm probably just like, yeah, I'm doing it. And then no words are exchanged. I just grab the gummy and I'm probably the first one to put it in my mouth.
So you like, you don't send intention, you don't send energy. Nope. Okay. Nope. So what I'm having you both do is you're going to each in turn roll for vibes, like how good your vibes are. And I think that Callie's going to roll with advantage and you're going to roll disadvantage.
Do I roll all of them?
Yeah. So roll both and then you take the better one and then he can like roll all four dice. And between the red and the white, like whichever, yeah. So like, what are the reds showing? They're a three.
They are.
Yeah, three.
And you're a five on white.
Five.
So your vibes are five. So maybe put like five marks on your sheet, because these are going to be important.
I grab my pen.
Okay. Well, why don't just roll for him? He's running away.
Oh wait, I thought the red was rolling for me.
No. So she rolled. The reason I have four dice here is you can roll four dice, and then with advantage or disadvantage, you can tell which is which pair instead of having to roll twice.
Just right. So the white is always advantage, and the red here. Is always disadvantage.
No. She rolled. Roll. Just roll all the dice.
Okay.
All right. There'll be a red number and a white number. You're going to take the worst one.
Three and eight.
So you're three.
Okay. I see.
There you go.
So I have my vibes are three.
Yeah.
Brad.
Put them wherever you
three
want.
Three vibe.
All right, so here's what happens after you take it. So you're all kind of hanging around the camp, and you like, you know, waiting to come up, sun's going down, and you're starting to notice, like, weird synchronicities, right? Like one person will, like, take their hat off, and someone else puts their hat on, but they don't realize they're doing this. And what else happens? Like, you know, one person, like, every time somebody leaves the camp, like, somebody else, like, shows up. And you're starting to kind of notice this, and you're sitting next to each other, And you're kind of like, whoa, like, did this just happen? Did that just happen? And at one point, you have this little conversation about a synchronicity, but then you have it again. And you have it again. And it's starting to feel like you're stuck in a time loop.
Oh, God.
And after what I'm going to guess is approximate here, let me roll for it. Infinity loops. You finally say to each other, are we stuck in a time loop? But you say it at the exact same time. And you just stare at each other in amazement at, like, what happens now? And then you start to notice around you reality kind of dissolving into, like, an infinite hexagonal grid. Or, like, no, not hexagons. You know how on a soccer ball, like, the grid is of, like, I think it's, like, seven-sided mm-hmm. because it's round? That's what you're seeing because reality is not flat. Ooh. You're seeing a soccer, infinite soccer ball pattern, and, like, the grid is made of brilliant white light, and the grid itself starts to expand, and the, like, negative space starts to shrink until everything, reality just dissipates, and everything is white, and you're in a featureless void. You're in a featureless void. I've been talking a while. I thought I'd give you a chance to do something. Like, I don't know, examine your surroundings, or...
I examine my surroundings.
Okay, are you good or bad at perception? Is that a strength or weakness?
I am good at perception.
Okay, so roll perception with advantage. What's your better one there?
They are the same. They are six.
Okay, you got a six. So with a six, you notice that you're in a featureless void.
Dude,
wonderful.
This is like, we're in purgatory, man.
Well, you only got a six. You didn't realize that he's there.
Oh, like, he's not even there.
He is there, but you rolled a six, so you don't notice this. So what do you want to do real quick?
Oh,
it's Brad's turn.
It's Brad's turn. Well, wait, I don't have to roll?
Well, do you want to examine your surroundings, or what are you going to do? Just tell me what you're going to do.
I feel like Brad would just be like, unimpressed.
All right.
Just, like, doesn't care.
Yeah, so you're unimpressed, and eventually you come to notice each other. Okay, yeah, so you see each other, and you kind of hear, like, a faint hum in the background, but it's not that perceptible yet. Do either of you want to do anything, or just kind of want to, like, wait, see what happens?
I feel like that hum, like, it totally sounds like this, like, singing bowl that my mother had growing up, and I feel really connected to it. So I think I kind of want to go check out where I think the, like, singing bowl is, because, like, there might be people there that are, like, meditating to, like, find us, you know, because I feel pretty lost right now. Am I nailing it or what?
Yeah. It's like you've met these people before.
Maybe.
Well, okay, I'm confused. Are we...
in a featureless white void, yes.
We are in a featureless
white void. Sorry, according to my notes, a featureless white void.
Oh, that's awesome.
But we can tell the direction, at least, that the sound is coming from. Like,
it's getting a bit louder, and on what where a horizon would be, you're starting to see, like, a little blob.
Are we walking, or are we, like, floating?
You haven't told... You're in the middle of it. You're not moving unless you choose to move.
Yeah, but I mean, like, are our feet, like, do we, like...
It feels like you're on a floor, but you can't see one.
Okay.
Okay, are we aware of each other?
Yeah, I think by now you figured out each other here.
Okay, so I'm in a featureless white void, and I look over and I see... What was your name?
Everybody calls me Starseed.
Starseed. I see Starseed. I think at that point, I don't know, I'd probably be like, I'm bored. Like, I probably wouldn't follow. I'd probably try to exit. Try to find the door.
So you're walking away from her.
Yeah, I'd try to find the exit.
Okay,
sign.
No. But, like, you need to understand. Like, look around you. There's, like, there's literally nothing here.
Yeah, there's no techno, so I want
to
leave.
Okay, but, like, just, like, I just need you to, like, just, like, put a little bit of trust in me. Just trust. We can just go.
I just, like, pull out a cigarette and light it and just stare at you really, like...
So you have like a cigarette in your inventory?
Yes.
Okay.
Right. And a lighter.
Cigarettes apparently. And lighter. Are those your two items?
The lighter's in the pack of smoke, so it's one.
I think that's fair. Yeah. Yeah. Pack of smokes with the lighter in it.
Nice loophole.
Yeah. I don't know if the categories matter. We know what it is.
Pack of smokes plus lighter.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not enthused, but I guess if I haven't found the exit sign, I probably would follow Starseed, because realizing that, you know, being that balls high, you just got to kind of go with it.
So. Right. Okay, so you're not going to walk away from her.
Yeah, I'll follow.
Okay. So you're walking towards the noise. Mm. So what you see, it's actually kind of a familiar sight the closer it gets. Have you ever seen the Welcome to the Black Parade music video?
Yeah.
So you see a parade float, and you see these like figures on it, and they got these uniforms on, and you kind of see the person in the, like, there. You hear music that has like an MCR vibe, but it's not an actual song you've ever heard. It's kind of just sounds like, it sounds like five songs being played at once, but somehow it's perfect. And as it approaches, you get a good glimpse of the figure in the on the front of it, right?
Oh my God, is it Gerard Way?
It looks like Oscar Wilde cosplaying as Gerard Way. So you see this figure. Hang on a sec. I have something for this.
Suiting up.
Sorry, I thought that was the Prince of Christmas.
Well, that was last night.
All right. So, yeah, he's got a jacket kind of like this, but like it's more of an entire suit deal. And so, like, this thing comes louder and, like, the ethereal music gets louder. And it feels like the parade is, like, simultaneously coming towards you and moving away from you and, like, moving past you. Until it finally just seems to, like, converge on a single point, and it's... the parade is just stopped in front of you, and the singing stops, and they all look very solemnly down at you. They're just like spitting distance away now.
Do they look sad?
A bit. Well, why don't you roll for your perception? You have advantage on that, right?
Yeah.
All right.
What do you keep hitting?
The PlayStation. 5.
Yeah. So it looks very serious. They all look very serious. They're all just looking at you.
Are they men? Are there women there?
So they all kind of have like an androgynous vibe. The person in front seems a bit male-coded. Like I said, just imagine like Oscar Wilde, like a very foppish dandy. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it's like wearing, you know, like a very like traditionally masculine suit. But you kind of suspect this person might like transcend gender.
I mean, I could be into that.
All right. Do you guys want to do anything?
I don't know.
Okay, so sensing your hesitation, the person in the front finally speaks up. Hello! I am the Prince of Christmas! Oh, how are you both?
I think we're like a little bit lost. And we just need some, like, directions, I think, to get back. Also, I should also mention that she's, like, incredibly, like, unforgivably stoned at all times. Mm-hmm. So she's, like, super slow.
Okay.
Yeah, Brad's probably just, like, just smoking a cigarette. And
just tweaking.
Like, not even tweaking. Just, like, just looking for a way to just ditch this situation, you know? Just, like... what are you doing here?
I sense that you're wanting to ditch the situation, Brad. I wrote very high in my perception. Yes. I'm afraid you cannot do that. Go ahead. Try and walk away. Okay. I invite you.
All right. I just turn around, start walking away.
All right. So you walk for what feels like 8 hours, and like you can hear them saying goodbye, eight hours. And like and the voices kind of like slowly trail off behind you. After 8 hours, you finally get like the... you know, the tumescence to look behind you. That's not what that word means. You get the tumescence to look behind you, and you haven't moved an inch.
Oh my God, that's terrifying.
Yeah.
All right.
That felt like 30 seconds.
I feel like that would start to become a slightly worrying situation.
Oh, I sense you're worried, but fear not. Do not be worried. No. Well, okay. You may be worried, but fear not. I am on your team. So... I have brought you both here for a reason. He throws a lot of trilled R's into like weird places. It doesn't make sense. Don't blame me. Blame the Prince of Christmas. Blame Christmas.
Yes, yeah. Of course.
So like he does have a mask. Yeah, I'm going to use him because he does have a very masculine title. There might be a reason for it. He says, "You two, do you know why both of you are here and not any of your friends?"
I mean, quite frankly, I'm just a little bit wary of the situation because I feel like I was brought here against my will by somebody with a very masculine energy. And I just really don't think that that is, like, cool. Because, you know, it's like, it's whatever the year is.
I believe it's, like, current year.
It's like, it's 2020. What fucking year is it?
2022.
It's 20. I'm so exhausted.
You know what? Just roll two dice and it's 2010 plus that year.
It's 2017.
All right, 2017.
Yeah. Good year. Good vintage.
Yeah.
Was feminism even a thing back then?
Dude, that was like 5 years ago.
it was getting there, yeah.
I feel like I've been brought here against my will. And I just, like, I was not asked properly for consent to have this experience. And I just think that you need to recognize that and perhaps apologize, perchance.
Oh, I do. I must apologize for my extremely masculine energy. I'm known for being the most masculine of all the people in the heavenly church.
So like a man to brag.
Yeah. But it's because of my extreme take charge attitude that I have been entrusted with bringing you to this realm against your consent. Noted. But the stakes, you see, are so high for...
Oh, sorry, I'm a vegetarian. I don't eat steak.
He does not understand it. He just looks at you and he's like, "Oh, you're confused. No, I mean what's another word for steaks? The prospects of what could go good or bad. It's so earth-shattering. Christmas is in peril."
Oh no, do we have to save Christmas?
You do! Oh, you now, perhaps your perception is better than I thought, Brad.
I'm also not religious. Like, I think that we're all just like a part of the same energy, and like, I just don't think that like Christmas is like respectful of other people's cultures, she says while twirling her dreadlocks.
Mm-hmm. You know, you're very correct, but there's simply no time to get into an epistemological debate about Christmas. What you should understand is that there is a universal energy that connects everything, but it's filtered through and to you via the lens of Christmas. Some people have gotten it a little twisted, but the point is, if you don't save Christmas, the universal life force that connects us all will be shattered.
Shit.
And all of the crystals in your bathroom sink, Starseed, will be useless.
Oh, fuck.
Yeah, that gets you going. Right? Yeah.
But because I do want to respect the concept of consent, I will ask you: do you take up the mantle of this very important duty? No one else can do it. It's only you, the two people with the most fucked vibes of this entire festival.
I think Brad probably jumps at the fact that he would get credit for it. So he's like, "I'm in."
Are you so okay? I'm like really stoned right now. I just need to kind of like recap what just happened. Like, are you saying, like, for real, real, like, no cap, that Christmas literally runs everything?
That is the best way to understand it with your tiny mortal brain, Starseed.
Straight bussin', no cap, sort of deal.
Straight bussin'!
Okay, and like, if we don't do this, then like, are people gonna like die, or...?
A fate worse than death, and in fact, I may not have the power to send you back to your plane. You may be in this featureless void forever! Do you like featureless voids?
I mean, it's kind of peaceful. It reminds me of this one time that I went to Vipassana meditation and like, hit this like crazy point of like Kundalini that like I had never reached before. But I mean, like,
I'm not familiar with Kundalini. Is that one of those Italian pastas?
It's delicious.
Oh, I love it. You'll have to tell me more about it later, but please, we are in haste. There's no time to lose. Christmas is in peril now, and we must start planning it now in July.
If people are gonna die, I feel like I can't have that blood on my hands.
Let's go with that then. People are going to die, Starseed.
Well, thank you for using my chosen name. I really appreciate that.
Oh, of course. I've already forgotten your normal name.
Okay.
All right, onward.
He knows it's Courtney. He's lying. So he reaches into his jacket pocket and he throws three keys up in the air, kind of like between the two of you.
And we have to grab keys before they hit the ground or what?
It's your life.
I have terrible agility and reaction.
All right.
So
you both going to try to grab them?
Yeah, I try, but I for sure miss.
I try to grab all three.
I want you to both roll. Are you skilled or unskilled in that?
Agility.
You have agility? Okay, so you roll with advantage, you roll with disadvantage.
That's a 7.
Yeah, you keep getting the second red one, not on camera.
That is a 9.
Okay, so you get two of them, and you get one of them, but you kind of like bump it, and it like lands on the Features Void ground, like right next to your feet.
Can I use this for ketamine?
He bumps.
Oh, as soon as you look back, Prince of Christmas is gone.
I'm going to use this for ketamine.
All right. Do you have ketamine in your inventory or?
No.
Okay. It's probably for the best. You're already on like way too much LSD. Yeah. So, when you pick up and examine the keys. So, let me just. Okay. I'm just rolling to see which ones you have. Okay. So, I'm going to start with your key. Your key has, it's the inscription on the like the base of the key is like a really sad looking woman. Yeah.
How big are these keys?
It's sort of like, I'm going to say this long. And this picture is about that like big. Like it's kind of comical, but like you can still hold it. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's a very sad looking woman. And whatever Starseed perceives as a sad woman is how it shows up in your eyes. Mm. If he looked at the key, it would look like his interpretation of that phrase. And then your keys are, it looks like a bunch of tiny beings packed into a small space. Like they're almost like fighting against each other for space on this key. They're all a bit distorted and
that's
like
one of the keys
jammed.
I have?
That's one of the keys you have. And then the other one has a just like a dark robed hooded figure. Like it's just like sort of like a featureless black void in a robe look, but you can tell it's staring at you somehow.
Mm. Is it like the baby dolls that like wherever you walk in the room they're always looking at you?
Yeah, like when you put the key in your pocket you feel like it's staring at you from your pocket.
Gross.
Ew.
Yeah.
Gross.
And when you look around the keys you realize that there are three doors in front of you with kind of like logos on them that match what's on the keys.
Oh no. Okay, so the puzzle has presented itself immediately. All right. I feel like I would just sort of casually walk up, like smoking all cool. I hate that smoking is cool.
To which door?
Well, to just get a good view of the logos on the doors.
They match exactly what's on the keys.
Oh, they match exactly.
That'd be too easy.
The keys are also slightly different sizes, and the door, like, lock.
So is it very obvious that each key matches each door, and that's...
I would say that. You can try to put another door.
Okay. So, at this point, I guess we have to choose which key to use first.
Like, do you think it's something that's, like, obviously the keys match, but do you think it's, like, an order kind of thing?
Well, if they obviously match and they are not intended for those doors, then there's, I don't know, what malicious intent involved? Like, the puzzle is meant to be...
Or as my phone would write it down, militia's intent. Like a militia, apostrophe S.
The intent of the militia.
Sorry, you were on a whole thing there. Is there more Old Milwaukee unofficial beer of the program?
Yes, there is. There's a fridge in the
room. Oh, you put it in the fridge. What an idea.
I know, right?
You guys deliberate for a bit.
All right. So we're standing in front of the doors. Oh, I feel like Brad would just like want to vibe on this.
Oh, no, it's that one right
there. Brad would want to like vibe on this and try and figure it out himself, but you're like annoyingly fucking talking to me and like making it hard for me to think.
Sure.
Yeah, I would love one. Sponsored by Cal and Gary's.
And cold Millie's.
Now that we're actually in Calgary, we can talk about how much money co-op is paying
us. And the Prince of Christmas suddenly like whips in out of the darkness and hands you old Milwaukee's and says, hey, have some old Milwaukee's. Truly, you want to know the truth of the universe. They are the greatest of all the cheap beers. Please sponsor us.
Truthfully, the greatest of all the cheap beers. Oh, man. Okay.
He's gone again.
Okay, back to deliberation.
Oh, my God.
I'm overthinking this. And Brad would be too.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like I take... Well, the key with the cramped...
A voice comes out of the void. Yeah, overthinking this.
Oh, I would find that so annoying. I feel like there's two options in the keys that I have. I'm not interested in the key she's got. There's a whole bunch of people that are cramped together, and there's a key with a dark figure on it.
Yeah, like a hooded robe thing.
Both of those seem like shit. I think I would try the...
I mean, Christmas is in peril. He's not going to have a good time.
I think I would try the hooded robe one first.
All right.
And is it... I mean, like, is it, like, open the door and walk through it, or is it open the door and inspect? I would choose to open the door and inspect.
Yeah, yeah. So you put the robe key in the robe door?
I guess I would do that first, yeah.
Okay, yeah. So you have taken initiative before her, so it definitely just happens. So you open the door, and inside this room... okay, we'll roll for your perception again.
Okay, so I'll just roll the red dice. We got 6.
Okay. And this was the robe door, right?
Yes.
You see at a distance a large man with a beard and big disgusting dreads, and there's like a something looks like a sign next to him. He has like a familiar vibe.
A sign next.
Is it bear beard, bear claw, bear?
Bear cat.
You rolled a 6, so I'm just describing what the person looks like from a distance. They're a bit silhouetted, and they're kind of like they appear to be like at a table.
Is this like the merchant from Resident Evil? What are you buying?
I don't know.
Khajiit have wares if you have coin.
So we're in a featureless white void. And there's a door open in front of me that leads to something that is not a featureless white void.
Yeah, like the...
This is some Kingdom Hearts shit, man.
Yeah, so like the room, from what you can see, it like definitely looks like a room that has walls and a ceiling. And it's like... It seems really indoors. Like, it's... You can't perceive what you would think of as like windows.
All right. Probably I would slam the door and try the other door.
Yeah, sure, why not?
Now that I have, like, an idea... Is that the chair...
Oh, you can hear it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it keeps making these horrible fart noises. Like, and the chair is making horrible fart smells, too. It's weird.
I was like, is there an elk dying, like, upstairs?
There might be. So hold on. So you have opened the first door. What do you do while he's doing that? Like, you have agency. You're a modern woman. You can make choices.
Yeah, no, I think I would, like, especially just, like, from judging what the image is of the key, it, like... touches my poor little feminist heart, and it makes me think that there's
what is the image again?
It's like of a sad woman, I think.
Yeah, I thought you said poor little feminine heart, and I'm like, man, you're kind of leaning into these.
No.
Okay, sorry, go ahead.
And I would have just like immediately gone, because I think my like the line of thinking would be like there's like a woman in trouble in there or something. So I would just go on like try and unlock it right away.
Okay, so you unlock it, and what you see inside is like a tranquil forest, and they're... Wait, sorry, you roll. I think your perception is advantage,
yes.
Right? Yeah. We could have explained the game mechanics to the audience, but we didn't.
9.
Everyone has picked strengths and weaknesses. They have to pick one strength per weakness. All of their strengths, they roll with advantage, meaning they roll 2 numbers, keep the best one. All their weaknesses, they roll with disadvantage, meaning roll 2 numbers, keep the worst one.
Can I do a quick little ASMR?
Crisp.
Oh, we love ASMR. This is another motif. Do you want to make some weird mouth noises in the microphone?
Oh, please don't. No, not one. No, no. Please. It's terrible. No, no, no.
So with a 9, you do hear that sound emanating like faintly from this forest, but you see a tranquil forest and you kind of see some like some kind of like quadrupedal figures seem to be kind of like moving in the distance, and you hear kind of like a soft moaning. Like, did you ever play Left 4 Dead?
No.
No.
Oh, really? Okay. Well, for the audience, it kind of sounds like the way the witch like whines and wails.
Honestly, when you say quadrupedal figures, the first thing I imagined was like the video of that girl that runs like a horse.
Have you ever is this like the puppy girl play or like?
No, she literally just like runs around on all fours and like does like horse jumps and stuff. Like, it's not the way that a human should move at all.
Hmm. It's not that.
Okay.
With a 9, you know it's not that.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's what you see. So you've each opened a door. You're slamming a door. He's walking to the other door. Are you going to walk through or?
Because I am a starseed indigo child, I do want to make sure that one of my fellow humans, although he is a man, I do want to make sure that he's okay, because now I kind of feel in charge of him. You're like in charge for his safety.
Wait, are you talking about me?
Yes.
I would have pegged you walking straight through that door.
I will leave the door open, but I'm going
to... She would have pegged you if you asked.
I'm going to leave the door open, but I'm going to like... Just kind of like, I'm not going to like go after him because I don't, sorry, I'm not going to go after him because I don't want him, you know, to think that like, I'm like worried or like bending to his will or anything, but I am just going to do like a little curious peek to see what he's up to and like what he's seeing.
Okay. So you're going to watch him open the third door.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So yeah, you open the third door and, is your door still open?
Yes.
Okay. So roll your perception here. Just normal roll.
Myself?
Yeah.
Nine.
You see exactly what she saw.
Wait, the door with the crowded bunch of people on it.
Yep.
I open it up and I see a forest.
Yep.
Interesting.
Do I see that?
Yeah. Yet? You're both still seeing, because if the door is still open, you're both now seeing the forest, and it's like you're seeing from
right. But like, do I know that that is what he's seeing at this other door? Because I'm kind of just
if
like,
you craned your neck, yeah, you could probably see that.
Okay.
It kind of just looks like there are two doors literally next to each other in a wall, and they are both open to the same room.
Okay. If we like both peer in at the same time through the different doors that are showing the same thing, what happens?
You notice that the other person is like 3 feet away from you. Like same as on the other side of the door.
Yeah.
Doors are like a foot apart. You lean in. Hey, you're right there.
So it's like the same.
Yeah.
The same thing.
It looks like two doors for the same room.
Okay. And what was in the other door again?
The first door?
Yeah.
I don't know. Door. Do you remember, Brad?
Yeah, I do. It was a dark cloaked figure with long dreadlocks. I can't remember the rest, but it was definitely an interior room.
Okay, so you're telling me that Christmas is in trouble.
You're using that voice, but the Prince of Christmas is gone.
I know.
Okay.
You're telling me that Christmas is in trouble, and something is making Christmas in trouble.
It's up to you to solve it.
But it's up to us to solve it.
Yeah.
But there's these like really nice, lush, green places that we can just like go and hang out in.
Yeah,
it's like a wintry forest.
Yeah, but I'm like all about nature.
I feel like I'd go back through the middle door, the first door that I opened, because it fits my aesthetic.
Okay,
it fits my aesthetic, right?
All right, you're just going it. You're duding your way through. You just walk in.
I'm gonna like walk straight up and probably just like.
Wait! You're gonna open the third door right now?
I guess I closed it, didn't I?
You can open it again.
Yeah, I'm gonna open it.
Okay, again. You open it again and you see the snowy landscape.
Oh no. This is...
We fucked up.
Very confusing.
Like, sorry, like the same forest.
Wait. I step out and close my door and open it again.
You just close the one door and open it again?
Yeah.
It's trees.
I do it to all of them.
Okay, you close all the doors?
Yeah.
Okay, then what do you open?
All of them.
Which one do you open first?
The one that he opened that didn't have the shadowy figure.
Okay, so now you open that door. Okay, roll your perception when you open that door.
9.
Okay, so you see, it kind of looks like you're looking in on like, it's a very busy area. There's a lot of living beings in there. There's a lot of like, No, sorry. You're looking at like the outside of a building. There's a lot of little figures huddled around it and like muttering and kind of yammering and like a tongue you can't quite understand. And the voices are like, they're on like the higher end of the register. And yeah, they seem troubled.
Okay, I close all the doors and open them all again. It's like, how long can we keep this going? And that's the other two are still all nature-y.
If you close
shit. Oh no, he just peeped. It's all good.
If you close your door and then you open another one, you will see what was originally in it.
But there's no more black figure. There's no more, there's
if you close all the doors and open that third door on the far right, then you see the silhouetted large person with the beard and the nasty dreads that is like still hunched over the table. Okay. Nothing in any of the doors has changed. It's just when you leave a door open and you open a second door, it's just the first open door takes precedence. It's not a puzzle.
It seems like a puzzle.
It seems like a puzzle.
No,
things were changing as doors were opening, so it seems like a puzzle.
The first door you open is what shows through everything. Once you close them all, it's whatever you open first.
Okay.
Okay, so it was a puzzle.
So the Prince of Christmas comes zooming by again. It's like, I promise you, the doors are not a puzzle.
Okay.
I probably like get snarky and look back at him. It's like, look, I've seen Star Trek: The Next Generation.
He's gone.
I know who fucking Q is. All right.
Yeah.
Like, this is bullshit.
Okay, well, we should just pick a door.
Yeah, I mean, I was planning.
This is metagaming, but you should pick a door.
I was planning when I went back to the door that I originally opened.
Yeah.
I was expecting to see that dude with the dreads.
Yeah.
Hunched over the table, and you said that it was just.
Yeah, trees. But that's because the trees door was still open. Okay, when you did the experiment of closing all the doors, and then you open that third door, it does show that.
Is that
thing.
Not a puzzle?
No, I don't think so.
Oh God!
It's just you can't see two different things at once.
My intention was to go through that door and to meet that person.
Okay, well, if you close all the doors and you open that door, you see that thing. Do you want to walk through?
Yes.
All right. As soon as you walk through, all of the doors and everything fall away, and you're just both in that room. You are in like a kind of dungeony looking room, and you now that you're in the room, you can see that this. You're a little mistaken in the dreadlocks. What you're actually seeing was like a kind of a pointed hat with like a little bobble on the end. And he's, yeah, wearing like kind of like a red suit and
fucking Santa.
It's a pretty Santa looking figure, but like the most haggard, bedraggled Santa you've ever seen.
Prison Santa.
Yeah. Prison Santa.
Well, you're also noticing that like he's hunched over the table in a way that he's like chained to it.
Oh God.
And he's kind of like, he seems to be weeping softly.
Okay. This one's on you. I'm going to take a quick bathroom break. So okay. You can workshop that for sure.
Brad's taking a smoke. No, Brad goes to piss in the corner, like literally.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, there's a chamber pot.
Does Santa notice us coming in?
It doesn't seem like it. Like, I mean, he's kind of like, he's facing kind of away from you. And he's chained to this table. He can't really move. He could maybe turn his head, but he's not. He's just kind of staring straight ahead and like weeping softly.
I would... probably just like walk up pretty concerned and just like kind of start like, oh, hi, Jack. Start like rubbing his back a little bit and be like, hey, man, like you doing all right? Like
he just kind of shakes his head while continuing to sob and goes, oh, oh, oh.
Okay. I can tell there's something wrong because that is literally the reverse of what you're supposed to be saying.
That's right. You're very perceptive. You notice he doesn't seem to be having a good time.
I have sage in my inventory, mm-hmm. But I don't have a lighter. Brad, can I borrow your lighter, please?
Yeah, I guess.
And I light some sage and I start smudging.
You start smudging. There's a door to this room. And it bursts open, and you see like a cloaked figure walk in, and it looks exactly like just kind of like the way you'd perceive like a Grim Reaper. It's basically, and the voice sounds like Norm Macdonald, so like it's exactly like I can't do that voice, but that's what it sounds like.
Yeah, Turd Ferguson.
Turd Ferguson.
Yeah. So he's like, Oh no, wait, it doesn't sound like Norm Macdonald because it has a voice. The hooded figure goes like, "Hey, what are you doing? Why are you burning this in my dungeon? Who are you?"
Sorry, I'm clearing the evil spirits.
No, I am an evil spirit. I don't like this.
Yeah, so that's like kind of the entire point of this exercise. And I just need you, if you could just close your eyes for a second and just take some deep breaths. There's some things that need purging in this room.
Okay, so he reaches out, like he walks up to you and he like reaches out a robed hand to go touch your sage. And as soon as he touches it, it just like wilts and turns into ash. No sage. Well, we no sage Christmas. In my dungeon.
Jack, I need you to kindly fuck off for a sec here, bud.
Cat is also evil spirit. Don't mind him.
Who? Wait, what?
The cat. The cat is also an evil spirit. Don't mind him. There's a cat in this dungeon. It is cuddling you, but it has like bad vibes. Like you feel like it's gonna.
Look at the vibes of him.
You feel like the cat would claw you as soon as you stop paying attention.
You're stuck with this cat now. Well, I'm now just crying about the loss of my sage that I collected myself from a beautiful forest off the highway somewhere.
So as you're crying, the hooded figure takes Santa's belt and pulls it off and like pulls Santa's pants down like to the bottom of his ass and takes the belt and just starts whipping and is like, "This is what happens. This is what happens, Mr. Claus. You don't give me my money, this you get punished, you understand?" And Santa's just going, oh. Listen, are you here to help with punishment or are you just here to be annoying?
I think Starseed's having flashbacks of why her mother is a single mother.
Oh my god.
She's just remembering the belt getting brought out and like just kinda like crumbles and like doesn't really know what to do.
Okay, so you just got, like, a freeze response to all this.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, Brad is just, like, starting to regret even being involved. Just does not want to be a part of this.
All right. And, so several minutes of whipping, what does the road figure do? I had, like, 2 hours come up with this, okay? So, the road figure, like, walks over to a wall and gets, like, okay, like what's a Christmas themed thing?
Trees, reindeer, lights, snow,
gingerbread,
skating.
Fruitcake,
pumpkin pie.
Oh, okay. So he goes and gets a gingerbread man, right, off the wall. Goes and gets a gingerbread man, and he takes a big bite out of the leg. And
not the buttons.
And Santa goes, oh, and like his leg starts like spasming and he's in like intense pain.
Christmas voodoo.
Yeah. and the hooded figure is just like, yes, this is how we break kneecaps in the ethereal plane.
I like how the evil dude is just Russian.
Yeah.
Topical.
It's just a voice I can do.
Okay.
I'm still in like freeze mode.
All right. So what else does he do? He walks up to the front of Santa and he says, "You don't like when I hurt you. You don't want me to hurt you anymore." And Santa goes, "No, oh, and he's like shaking his head and he says, "Okay, then it's your turn." And he like sticks the other leg of the gingerbread mouth in Santa's mouth and like forces him to bite it. And the same thing happens where Santa's other leg starts like spasming and he's just like the most intense pain. And like, he almost just, like, it seems like his legs are like withering as this happens.
It's got dark.
Yeah. Well, that'll happen. Careful what you take, kids.
Yes. This is a PSA. This is just a public
service. This is a cautionary tale.
Yeah.
To not ingest research chemicals.
I mean, I don't really have anything to, like, in my inventory, I put sage and rolling papers.
So you have rolling papers, but you have no. So that, so the hooded figure notices that you're still there and is like, "Listen, I don't have time for this. Why don't you just leave? The door is over there and the, if you don't leave, I won't use my evil anti-pope powers on you."
Anti-pope?
I am the anti-pope. I am anti-pope Constantine.
Okay, I'm kind of into that.
What?
Yes.
Anti-religion, people, just spirituality only.
People don't realize it, but there's usually an anti-pope. Sometimes it's just less public.
I have an uncle pope. Bad?
He,
no?
He
no.
also just stares at you and doesn't understand. You're like, oh no, you don't understand. You see, anti-pope means anti. Sorry, is my accent. But the it just means that I am like seated in opposition to current pope, and I have, you know, big conflict with church and also with this man who owes me money. I don't know why I'm giving you all this expository information. I must torture him. And then, so he goes and he gets like a Christmas tree. And Santa's going, go!
This is like the most intense trip that I've ever had. Like,
and you guys gonna do anything or?
I'm frozen. Like, I don't even know how to respond. I have nothing. I have nothing in my inventory that can help. Maybe if anything, I'm like really stoned and notice the cookie and like accidentally take a bite, forgetting what it did.
Brad.
What part do you take? What part of the cookie do you take a bite
just
out
like
of?
Just like a little bit of the hand.
As you take a bite out of the hand, you just watch like blood start like showering out of Santa's arm. And he goes, oh, you just like, but it's also getting more faint. It just feels like he's just like, he doesn't even have the life energy to like scream anymore almost.
Oh my God. I think I just realized something. Listen, Brad, Chad, so was it Chad?
Oh my God. It's Brad.
Brad. Sorry. I smoked a lot of weed. Anyway, like none of this is real. You know,
it's Christmas.
Yeah, like Christmas. Like none of this is. Like, I'm just gonna eat this cookie. I eat the cookie. I eat the whole fucking thing.
Brad just like looks at you disapprovingly. Like he's like, this is clearly a stupid idea, but does not say a word. Just lights another cigarette.
I see the look of disapproval, and it makes me eat the cookie even faster.
So when you, as you were eating the cookie, the like Santa starts to scream, but also like wither and shrivel and is becoming like a husk. And what the anti-pope Constantine, like, he starts realizing you're doing this because he has kind of low perception. He was really focused. He was in flow, right? He was in a flow state of torturing Santa. yeah. And so he realizes what you're doing, that you're like, he's like, oh my God, what are you doing? No, I need him alive. I need to get money back. And he's freaking out because like he tries to grab it from you and the cookie's gone. So he flies into a rage and he's gonna just reach out and like, he's just gonna like put his like robe hand up to your neck and like grab your neck. And
I'm strangely into it.
Oh, so you're not gonna like do anything counter. You're just gonna
nope.
All right. I want you to roll one. What's your vibe score?
Five.
Okay. I'm just gonna roll here. Okay. So you lose 4 vibe points. You're down to 1.
Oh fuck.
Yo, how the fuck
is that like my HP?
Starseed.
Yeah.
Welp.
Yeah. So you kind of like fall to the ground writhing in pain, and you feel like, you suddenly feel like all the pain Santa felt. You feel it in both your legs. You feel it in your butthole, and like nothing's you're shriveling a little, but you're still alive.
I would like to add also that she probably starts hearing a wasp.
Sure.
No relation to personal experience.
No relation to personal experience.
Yeah, no, any resemblance to any, like, real people or experiences.
And the wasp sound just, like, keeps echoing and echoing and echoing for eternity, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, you definitely hear some, like, you know, like, cartoon characters see stars around their head? You're hearing wasps around your head. And, the robed figure does kind of, like, walk over to a wall and he grabs like a big Grim Reaper scythe and he's like, oh, you're going to regret this, you're going to be next. But he's like walking really methodically, like the T-1000. Like he's, you know, he's not running
with purpose.
Yeah, so he's walking over to the wall. He's walking towards a big scythe on the wall.
And there's nothing else in this room. It was just like
there's a lot of implements of torture. There's the door that he was saying like you can leave if you're not gonna if you're gonna annoy me.
How far away is the door?
I would say it's like if he's walking towards like that wall and you're sitting like here, the door is just kind of like there where that hallway is.
And how withering am I and how far away is he?
He's like, kind of standing right, I would say. Well, did you go stand in a corner to smoke or did you just stand right there and do it?
Stand right there.
Yeah, so he's just kind of standing over you and you kind of, you know.
Like, when you say he's walking methodically, is it like a comical, like, zombie walk? Like a very slow, like, like, you know?
Sure. Yeah.
Like, are we close enough to the door that we could just fuck off?
You could try it.
Would I have to be dragged? Like, how injured am I? Am I super
I think you could get up. Like, you got adrenaline, I feel. Like, you got it. Well, I mean, unless you're really into that freeze response, you might just lay in the ground if that's how you react.
I have no agility. I have no intelligence. And
you don't have advantage.
But I'm shitty at them.
Yeah. So you could try to do those.
But I'm very resilient.
You're resilient?
Yeah. I picked that because I figured she probably does a lot of drugs. Okay, and, like, so I'm going to roll a disadvantage
on your... Okay, so you... Wait, how many points did I say you lost? 4?
I have 1 point left.
Yeah. You had 5 to start?
Yeah.
Okay, well, okay. Rolling with disadvantage, you still lost 4, so... Yeah, so... You want to try to do something?
Yeah, I think we'll just try and leave.
Yeah, all right. So roll with... roll your agility with disadvantage, I guess.
Six.
We got a 6? All right. What are you going to do in this moment?
Brad's probably standing there just like, he knows this is not real. So he's just like, whatever. Come at me, bro.
Okay. So I would say that you get to your feet, but by the time you get to your feet, he's like looming over you with the scythe. He's like, are you going to leave? Is that what's happening?
Yeah.
So he kind of just like smokes you with the flat of the scythe and he's like, get the fuck out.
I do that. Right. That happens.
Yeah. All right. That happens. So you start walking towards the door and he's like, hey, you fuck boy. What's your deal?
I should have named my character fuck boy.
Yeah.
What's my deal? I don't know. I'm probably just looking him in the eyes. Just like, I don't know, you can't hurt me. You're not even real.
All right, he hits you with he swings a scythe at you.
Okay. So I don't even dodge.
Do you have an agility?
I do have agility advantage.
You don't dodge, though.
I don't dodge.
All right, so... Okay, so he does two vibes damage to you. Are you also down to 1?
Yes.
All right. So he's mad now. He's just really mad. So he starts walking towards you and like... trying to chase you out the door.
I'm like crawling away, like army crawling.
All right. He kicks you in the ribs. It hurts, but it doesn't like. Yeah, it doesn't do any more damage to you. He walks over to Santa to see if he can like reanimate him somehow.
But I've eaten necromancer.
Yeah, he's a withered husk, but like you know the anti-pope is a bit stunned by this. He was not expecting you to kill Santa. So he's kind of like stunned and he's just like thrown for a loop.
I kind of just figured that like if I just ate the cookie and killed Santa, then that just like eliminates the problem.
Well, I'm like Brad at this point, he's just like realizing that he actually not experiencing physical pain, but experiencing a diminishing vibe. And he's like, this is bullshit. So
did you say Brad, like he's slender, like he's not like a built dude?
No, okay. Yeah, he's slender, stoic.
You're now like dangerously skinny looking because you've withered a bit.
Yeah. But I feel like he would just like turn around and be like, this is bullshit. And knowing that this is not real, it's just like a plane of imagination and hallucination. But just turn around and like full out like Kamehameha, like Eldritch blast towards the motherfucker who just hurt me.
Okay, so you're going to attack him.
Yes, I'm going to attack him.
All right, so the moment she crosses the threshold of the door, you find yourself back in a featureless white void.
Just at the thought of attacking?
No, like as soon as she crossed the door. Away. As soon as she crossed the threshold, you're both in a featureless white void. That third door is gone. 2 more doors.
Jesus.
I want to go to that nice place.
I guess, yeah, fuck Santa.
Pretty sure I already killed him.
So you hear the Prince of Christmas roll up. How have we already forgotten the Prince of Christmas is voice? What? You killed Santa? Don't you understand? That's not saving Christmas. That's the opposite. Why would you kill Santa?
I was really hungry. I'm sorry.
You're both the worst. It may still be possible. You just
need... I can make myself throw up. I do that on ecstasy like all the time.
Great. So, you know what I mean when I say you need to save Christmas? You could, like, Santa's a key figure of Christmas, right? He needs to deliver the presents. Now someone else is going to have to deliver the presents.
What's your day job?
To
be fair, like, you're the one that's, like, super overly concerned about what's happening here, so I feel like if anybody is, like, bound to do it, it's probably...
Listen, I really want to send you back to your reality, but I may not be able to if Christmas isn't saved. Please, try to do better! And he vanishes.
Okay, so we have two more doors.
Yeah, two more doors.
Both of which previously showed the same thing.
Right, but because they were both open at the same time.
No, when you opened just the left door, it showed like huddled figures around like some sort of building.
Oh, really? I didn't... Okay.
I think it's because when you open two at the same time, it does something different. I don't
know. If you open a second door or a third door while the first door is still open, it just shows you what's in the first door.
Okay.
You can only see one thing at a time. That's
okay. It. Oh, so technically we don't know what's behind my door.
Yeah, we do.
Because
it's a snowy, wooded area.
No, because when I opened my door, one of the other doors was already open.
No, when you opened your door, he said he slammed it shut.
Right, yeah. Okay.
I pay attention.
If we've done one door and there's two more left, does that mean this...
The Prince of Christmas
campaign
does not show up, but you have this weird, like, echoing of his voice in your head going, the doors are not a puzzle!
Let's just walk through my door.
All right. So you find yourself in like a treed snowscape, and you can tell that the figures like darting around are probably reindeer.
Are there any reindeer cookies?
I mean, you want to look around for reindeer cookies?
I will. Yeah.
All right. Well, roll your perception. I don't remember if you're at advantage or whatever.
I do. Go on. 6. I'm rolling like ass.
Yeah, you didn't even, like, you rolled 2 visible dice on camera.
Should I re-roll?
No. What did you roll?
6.
6. Easy. You don't see any reindeer cookies. You just kind of see, it seems like you're in a forest where there are, you know, reindeer.
That's sad.
When I was chitting before, I opened up the Wikipedia page so I could remember what the reindeer were. There's some weird reindeer lore.
You mean like the actual reindeer of Santa?
Yeah.
You couldn't remember?
I wasn't 100% sure, and I was...
Do you have all of them memorized?
Dasher, Dancer, Prancer, Vixen, Comet, Cupid, Donner, and Blitzen.
I think I forgot Prancer.
Is it just 8?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But then they like retconned
it. Oh, and so, Rudolph.
So yeah, so they was like a century later, they're like, we're just adding a new reindeer. But also, there were stories where there was like 10... And then there's one, so it like there's a section on Wikipedia, reindeer introduced after Rudolph, right?
Oh my god, really?
There's a reindeer named Chet.
Chet? No.
Chet is a young reindeer in training who is introduced in the 2002 feature film, The Santa Claus 2.
Wait, The Santa Claus 2? Like
the
sequel with Tim Allen?
Of The yeah. Santa Claus.
Yeah.
Fuck, dude, that's not canon. That shit's not canon. It's not Santa Claus. Santa Claus is
Well, it's
real.
Canon. A young reindeer training waddles up to you and says, "Hi, I'm Chet. Are you here to help?"
Oh, you're so cute.
I know, but I'm having a real bad time, see? And he turns his flank to you and his like entrails are spilling out.
Oh my god.
Jesus fucking Christ.
Yeah. So
I like in vain just try and like pick up all of his guts and try and like shove them back in.
He screams in pain a lot, but it does seem to help.
Oh. ooh. I'm gonna pull out, like...
Rolling papers?
Yeah, I'm gonna pull out, like, a bunch of rolling papers and just, like, lick them together to try and make, like, some sort of, like, really...
makeshift...
Really shitty bandage for his entrance.
I'm just gonna say that works. And you lose your rolling paper because you used all of them.
Oh, no.
But give yourself like an inspiration, a bonus point.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can re-roll later.
Bonus point.
Yeah.
Sick.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, okay. So you named all the reindeer.
Yeah.
So one of the mechanics was going to be like, if you can name a reindeer, you can see what it's doing.
Oh, I can see all the reindeer.
Yeah. So do you want to name a reindeer? And
Blitzen.
Blitzen is stumbling around looking like completely wasted.
That's pretty blitzed.
Oh, I never thought of that. Yeah. And it is just like, it vomits into like a pail of vodka and then starts like slurping it up because it's still vodka. You have good perception and you can tell the pail is filled with vodka. You can smell the vodka from where you are.
I mean, cats do it with their own puke.
Yeah.
Put it past a drunk reindeer to do it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Dasher. I'm just going to go through them all.
Yeah. So Dasher is dashing towards you like in a way that looks like it's going to like smoke you.
Like angry?
He's just charging blindly.
How far?
It's like 10 meters away and closing. You have time to react.
Not with my reaction. I will attempt to move out of the way.
Is your reaction a disadvantage?
Yes.
All right, well then roll all those dice. Roll them to the back of the thing. We aimed this camera.
Wait, okay. Yeah.
Well, you got two of them.
Excuse me.
Okay, so what did you get?
Well,
they're both eight, aren't
they're
they?
They're both eight.
All right, eight is fine. Yeah, you jump out of the way, and Dasher smashes into Chet, which bursts his bandage.
No. I'm gonna run over to
no,
Chet.
No, that's not fair because you didn't like get a fail. He smashes into Chet's head, so Chet gets like a concussion, but
his insides are still inside.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, you did a good job. I don't want to be mean here. And yeah, that's what happens with Dasher.
And he just stops. He's just.
It's kind of like a bull gets up and starts like patting the ground and is looking right at Chad.
He's pissed.
Pissed, yeah.
Well, what's Dancer doing?
Okay, so Dancer is like dancing. And like grinding its jaw, and like it's got pupils like manhole covers, and yeah, it's kind of like drooling a little, and
okay,
yeah,
I'm gonna
and
skip.
It's just kind of like dazed and like maybe dancing like softly toward you.
I'm gonna skip ahead here and just assume that all of the reindeer are just like fucked up in one way or another.
Yeah,
in relation to what they're named after.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, in the interest of time. Yeah.
Yes. So the reindeer are fucked up. Normally I would try and burn some sage, but I don't have any sage left to burn.
Did you use all your sage?
I just said sage. I didn't say how many.
I feel like the anti-pope touched the sage you were holding, but I feel like we could be generous.
I
you
will
got
burn
more
sage.
All right, you burn some sage.
But I need your lighter to do it.
I very reluctantly pass you a lighter.
Thank you.
Yeah, as you burn some sage, Dancer seems to calm down a lot and lays down by like a bucket of water, starts lapping up water, and seems to be like kind of vibing on it.
Christmas is saved.
Christmas is saved. We did it.
Sage. You definitely saved one reindeer for sure.
Oh, God. We run to the other reindeer and do the same?
Which reindeer do you want to run to next?
All of them simultaneously we are high and we are in purgatory and
you've got five sage left.
Okay.
So which reindeer do you want to go do next?
Prancer.
All right. God, prancing is just dancing, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's like how a gazelle moves, like a boop, you know?
Yeah.
Like a boop.
Dancing gaily, but like gay as, you know, how it used to be, like just happy, gaily prancing.
Yeah.
All right. So you fixed the happiness.
Yeah. Oh, so he's sad now.
Prancer just looked like clinically depressed. And when you burn the sage, started prancing again. And you get the sense that Prancer's doing all right.
Oh, I should probably say...
You have four sage.
The fucking reindeer that I bandaged.
Chet?
Chet. I was going to say Clint.
It's not even
all right, Chet's wound heals miraculously. You're down to three sage.
What happens to the rolling papers that I put on him?
They melt away.
Hold on. So we figured out sage is fixing the problem.
I have how many left?
Three. Do we not?
We fuck off from the reindeer.
Throw sage in the demon's face?
Well, that's what I tried to do in the first place. And he was like, no, no sage.
Yeah, the antipa withered the sage. But it seems to be working here.
Maybe.
But we don't have enough.
Maybe. No, I have three sage. Should we maybe go try in the other door and see what's in the other door and see if the sage can help there? But, like, Santa's already dead, so we kind of fucked up.
I don't know.
Well, the Prince of Christmas said, like, it was still salvageable. He was just really upset.
Mm. What if you vomited up the gingerbread and we saged that?
I offered. I offered to try. I stick my finger down my throat.
You vomit up the gingerbread?
Yes.
Okay. So you vomit up the gingerbread and slightly dissolved. You immediately feel better. Wow, you gain 6 vibes points.
Holy shit.
Yeah. Make yourself throw up, kids. It's good for you.
This is a PSA.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. So here's what's going to happen here, actually. You vomit up the gingerbread and in through the door bursts the antipope, who comes and scoops up the vomit and is like, oh, yes, much better. I was wondering why he was showing signs of life. Thank you so much. Listen, maybe we got off on the wrong foot, but I'll offer you black magic deal. Do you want to trade any of your vibes for more sage? You now have 7 vibes.
I have 7 vibes.
Do you want to trade any for sage?
3 sage. And okay. How many reindeer did I help?
You've helped, I think.
I did Chet.
3? Yeah.
I did Prancer and Dancer.
Yeah. So there are 6 reindeer left. You have 3 sage and 7 vibes.
Okay, so if we're just like mathematicians here, you just trade enough of your vibe
for the rest for of sage the reindeer.
To go fix the rest of the reindeer.
Right, so yeah. What's the math on that? 6 reindeer left? So you only need to trade 3.
Yeah, 3.
Yeah, I do that.
Okay. So you're down to 4 vibes and 6 sage. All right. Which reindeer are you going to next?
Oh, my God. Dasher, Vixen.
You go to Vixen. Vixen is laying on her back, like, presenting to you and is, like, giving you the eyes. And
I might not need sage for this.
Okay.
Because my unique talent.
Yeah.
So I have the world's strongest vagina from doing Kegel exercises, literally consistency. Yes, even right now.
Okay.
So I scissor Vixen.
You're going to scissor Vixen?
Yes.
Yeah, so roll, what is it? Say plus 2?
Yeah.
Yeah. Does this play into any of your strengths or weaknesses?
Resilience? Persuasion? Persuasion.
Okay, but you have to. What are you gonna say that's persuasive as you scissor Vixen?
Get your fucking shit together.
Perfect. All right. So roll with advantage and add 2 to the best number.
9.
9.
So Vixen has the most like intense reindeer orgasm you've ever seen. And you've seen some reindeer orgasms.
Oh, in my day.
Yeah, and wanders off happy as a clam. And
I save some sage.
Yeah.
Donner.
So Donner is currently eating the entrails of several dead baby reindeer.
Baby reindeer?
Yeah, well, child reindeer, yeah. They don't have names yet. And they never will.
Chad, Paul.
Marty. You can name them if you want, but they're dead.
excuse me.
I'm getting more beer. Does anybody want more beer?
I'm good.
No, thanks. I think I'm good.
That's probably wise.
on the fucking PlayStation? That's not a cup holder.
That's fine.
Oh my god.
I use the sage on Donner.
Yeah, Donner's...
And hoping that, like, some of the sage, like, wafts onto the poor child reindeers.
The children are still dead, but Donner immediately stops committing cannibalism and wanders off happily.
Okay.
Sorry, that was a sage?
Yes.
All right. Who's left? I hope you're keeping track.
I am.
All right. No, keeping track of the reindeer.
Oh, no, I'm keeping track of the sage. Is it Cupid?
Yeah, you haven't done Cupid yet.
Cupid bounds up and is trying to fuck Brad.
I let him.
All right. Brad, do you do anything?
No. Just let it happen.
Yeah, so... just like the...
Peg the patriarchy, you know what I'm saying?
So just as happened in the... Oh, God, which book was it? Yeah, sorry, the Sleeping Beauty book. Cupid only uses his, like, reindeer pre-cum and starts going at it and it's like, it... Well, okay, so what's your resilience? Normal?
Bad at.
You're bad at resilience. Yeah. Okay, so roll resilience. Roll disadvantage here.
Oh,
wow, that was...
Mike, why is it... Okay, that's a 5.
It doesn't feel good.
I don't imagine it would.
Yeah. But it's, I mean, it's happening.
It happens.
All right. So Cupid busts and, are you at 1 vibe here?
I am at 1 vibe.
All right. So I was going to roll for how many, because this is still like a cursed reindeer. So I was going to roll for how many vibes you lose, but the minimum is 1. So you're on 0. So you're like laying on the ground, like slowly shriveling.
Okay. So I'm on 0 vibe.
You're at 0 vibe. But your teammate can save you here. So how much vibe do you have there? 4. So, okay. So your teammate here is down to 0 vibes.
Uh-oh.
Kind of in death saves, you might say. Mm-hmm. And, you can donate as many vibes as you want. But the process of donating vibes will cost you 1 vibe.
Well, yeah, because you're giving a vibe.
No, like cost 1 to like the bank.
Oh.
So if you give 1 tax. Yeah, if you give 1 in tax, it'll cost you 2 and he'll get 1.
I will give him 1 vibe.
All right. So knock off 2, you can add 1. All right. So you've cured Cupid in a way that cost you, but Cupid seems cured. Cupid's got that post-nut clarity and is now like just bounding happily. Clarity. Yeah.
Wait. Dasher, Dancer, Prancer, Vixen, Comet.
Okay, Comet is moving around real fast. Okay, we did this Dasher. Goddamn. Comet is running around really fast, but like aimlessly, and seems like it is just like exhausting itself. Like it just looks like it is about to like collapse in a pit of like seizing.
Sage motherfucker.
Yeah, how do you sage a fast moving reindeer?
I just kind of like hold it out and hope for the best.
I am
not fast.
All right, let's just do a straight roll. What happens?
Eight.
All right. Yeah, it works. Eventually, the scent of the sage, so you're down to 4 a sage,
mm-hmm.
Slows Comet down. And, yeah. Oh, also, you're still hearing the weird wailing. But it gets quieter with every reindeer you save.
And I didn't, like, Donner and Blitzen, did I do them already?
You did Donner, you did Blitzen. Yep.
So then that's all the reindeer.
What about Rudolph?
Is there Rudolph?
Yeah, I said there was 9 reindeer.
Oh, okay, well then Rudolph.
Let's see, you fixed Dasher, you fixed Dancer, you fixed Prancer, you fixed Vixen, you fixed Comet, you fixed Cupid, you fixed Donner and Blitzen.
Is Rudolph just like coked out and has a really red nose?
So, no, Rudolph has like a glowing red, so now that you've noticed Rudolph has noticed you, and you notice that the... So who is it that looked for Rudolph? Which of you looked first?
I think I would have.
All right. So you notice Rudolph's nose is glowing red, and like Rudolph's eyes are burning with mad fury. And as Rudolph looks at you, the nose starts like getting brighter and brighter, and like a loud humming goes. Wah.
It's a laser beam.
Sage, motherfucker.
You're too far away for Sage.
I get closer.
All right. So, Rudolph blasts you with this laser. It knocks off one vibe.
Yikes.
What are you at? One?
One.
Oh boy. So you're both at one here.
Yep.
Oh, you're on the knife edge. All right.
That's how we roll.
Oh, you can do anything?
I don't know. I mean, I didn't really envision this character being like ready for battle, right? I thought this campaign was going to be like,
yeah.
Why right? We could?
And so here I am trying to like.
What's your character good at?
Techno. I was instructed not Can to you... think about battle.
Yeah.
So here we are battling.
Did I say that?
Yeah.
Well, can you beatbox?
No, I would probably hate that.
Oh. Well, okay. You have one item was a pack of cigarettes.
Yeah.
What's your other item?
We didn't think of it yet. So, I don't know.
A sword.
A fucking katana? I would not. I don't think I'd be carrying a katana.
Something that could be useful here. I mean, like, think outside the box. I feel like that. What item would you have on you?
I don't know. I'm trying to think now. It's late and we've been at a festival.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm fucking
the brain power is running at an optimum low.
All right. So as he seems to be charging up again, this woman finally shuffles up. She's hitched all of the healthy reindeer to a thing and is like, oh, bless you. Bless you. You've saved all my reindeer. Oh, a sip for Rudolph. Oh, God. Have I mentioned how much he loves techno? It's the only thing that calms him down, but I simply can't beatbox, and I have no way of producing this music. My husband does, and I cannot find him. Okay, he's the tech guy. He's always talking about motion smoothing on the TV, and I don't understand it.
Well, so maybe what, I whip out a small Bluetooth speaker from my back pocket?
Sure.
And just, like, hold it to the air and, like, fucking thump, like, some killer techno.
All right, yeah, what does that techno sound like?
Oh my God, don't do this to me.
If you make some techno noise, it will cure Rudolph.
If I make some techno noise?
Yeah, I think so.
It's just boots and cats, man.
Boots and cats. Boots and cats and boots and cats and boots and cats.
And so Rudolph just starts like shooting lasers into the air and just like vibing.
Just fucking raving out.
Yeah, and it just lights the forest and you're like, oh wow. Now we can see the way out. And so Mrs. Claus goes and hooks Rudolph off to the front, and they take off out of the forest with all the presents in their sleigh. And she goes, thank you so much. And just a door appears.
Another door.
Yeah, it appears to lead back to a white featureless void.
Oh no, not that place again. Is this a Radiohead album?
Could be.
I guess we walk through to the void.
All right, you walk to the void. There's one more door.
One more door?
Oh, yeah. My God. I'm like...
I turn around and walk back.
All right.
I feel like it's scripted.
Yeah, you just, like, you walk away from the door?
I open the door.
Okay. So you walk through the door. There's like a huddle of elves outside of a building on their smoke break, and they all just look absolutely bedraggled, miserable, downtrodden, and they're like, we can't go on any longer.
I can relate.
Yeah. Yeah.
I use the lighter and I light myself on fire.
Jesus. I'm
sorry. We do have to go to bed.
Yeah, okay. You light yourself on fire and
like the monk style.
Yeah, you're protesting. Yeah. You're protesting
I'm not protesting the game. I'm protesting the fact that it seems like everything that we do never seems to get us anywhere. And
you cured all the reindeer.
I did.
We cured the reindeer, and then there was a brief moment where I think Christmas was saved.
All right.
And now we're still high as balls in a white void.
Yeah. So you set yourself on fire and it kind of snaps you back to the reality. And you wake up in a sort of like safe space, tripping balls and on fire.
Sanctuary.
And and like sanctuary you start on fire. Screaming. And this snaps Brad back to reality. And you were both. That's right. You both snap back to reality, and you and you're both screaming, and they have to like get water to put you out. So you're
actually on fire.
Yeah, you get some pretty severe like third degree burns. They got to take you to medical.
She lit her dreads on fire.
Yeah. And you're high for another, like, I don't know, that was about like an hour and a half of time. And oh, so
that sounds about right.
Yeah, you're gonna be high. That's what it
another
says
34 so. And a half
yeah
hours.
You got about another 34 and a half hours of like tripping. But yeah, and you're tripping in medical, and you maybe eventually get back to your camp, and you're trying to just tell people about like, yeah, so like there was a Prince of Christmas. And like it's all real to you now. And and then you got a cool story for your scars. And 6 months later, 5 months later, Christmas happens. But like, it's just like the worst Christmas ever. Like, you don't get as many presents as you expect.
I would be so disappointed if we helped save Christmas and then I had a shit Christmas like right after that.
Well, you partially saved Christmas because Christmas still happened, but it was worse. It was a mixed success.
We attempted to save Christmas, and then it just got so fucking disheveled. I gave up.
Yeah, Santa's probably internally pissed that you ate his legs.
Santa did come back to life. Like, you have a real bad Christmas, and then that was Christmas 2017, and they get like incrementally better again over time. Things kind of normalized.
All right, all right.
And and then you suddenly hear a dramatic swell of music.
Oh no.
Yeah.
Wandering Glump.
That's right. That's what we call it. Well, that was some of the stupidest shit.
I honestly didn't know if my talent was going to come in useful, but here we are.
I have no idea how to GM, so this is just what happened.
I was entertained. Are you still recording?